So I'd like to welcome you to the second presentation or second speaker of the UMD iSchool's Dean Speaker Series with Lionel. Our guest today is Lionel Robert. Lionel is an associate professor at the University of Michigan School of Information and also a faculty member at the University of Michigan's Robotics Institute. His research focuses broadly on collective action through technology and human collaboration, and particularly with autonomous systems. He's the director of the Michigan Autonomous Vehicle Research Intergroup Collaboration, or MAVRIC, an affiliate of the Center of Hybrid Intelligence Systems and the National Center for Institutional Diversity at the University of Michigan, and the Center for Computer Media Communication at Indiana University. He's currently on the editorial board of Management Information Systems, or MISQ Quarterly, MISQ Quarterly, the Journal of the Association of Information Systems, ACM Transactions on Social Computing, AIS Transactions on Human-Computer Interaction, and several others. He's a founding editorial board member of the Collective Intelligence. He's been active in a variety of conference program committees, including ICIS, CSCW, CHI, HRI, and AAAI. His research has been sponsored by the U.S. Army, Toyota, Research Institute, a variety of other companies and organizations, and has a wide variety of communications and interactions with the national and regional media. So we're very glad to have Lionel here to talk to us about his research. Given the number of editorial roles he plays, I have no idea how he has time to do research, but it's impressive. And he's got some very interesting things to talk about with regard to human-robot interaction. So, and just as a logistical thing for the audience members, today you'll not be able to see each other because we're using a webinar structure, but the chat facility is available. And if you want to chat so that everyone can see you, you'll need to go into the chat window. You'll see it says two panelists. You should change that so it says two panelists and attendees so that everyone can hear and or can see your comments. And feel free to post questions in the chat, and we'll return to that after Lionel's presentation for Q&A. So, welcome, Lionel.
All right, so thank you for introducing me. So I'll go from there. Okay, so let me give you, since Brian introduced me, I'll talk about some of my research areas. I study human artificial intelligence collaboration. So I've been doing stuff on AI trust, AI fairness, AI ethics, as also human robot collaboration. So typically an area of teamwork with robots, and then human autonomous vehicle interaction. We consider autonomous vehicles to be a type of robot. So we do a lot of work with human interaction with autonomous vehicles, both inside and outside the vehicle. For a rule of thumb for this presentation, at the University of Michigan, we differentiate AI from robot. Robots are AI with a physical embodiment that can act or react in the physical world. So, like, you know, if you go to Michigan, there's a Robotics Institute. And if you're in the Robotics Institute, you're studying an AI with a physical embodiment. We also have an AI lab, and typically it's AI with no physical embodiment. So that's pretty much how we separate the two areas. So I want to have an appointment in School of Information. And I also have an appointment in the Robotics Institute. So I sit in both areas. So I go back and forth. It's a funny thing, when I first got to Michigan, I'll tell you about my background. I assumed that I would spend a lot more time with people in Ross, the School of Business at Michigan, which actually I didn't. I actually spent a lot more time with people in engineers. It's kind of ironic, but most of my work in the Robotics Institute has been targeted toward engineering journals and some computer science conferences also. So kind of places I publish, give you an idea. I publish in journals like ISR, Journal Association Information Systems. If you ever heard of Transportation Research Part C, IEEE Robotics Automation Letters, International Journal of Social Robotics. So what you get there is anywhere from IS, maybe business school-y journals, to engineering journals, to robotics journals. Conferences, same thing, CHI, HRI, ICRA, if you ever heard of ICRA before, that's the main, so that's the main conference for engineers or and robotics, where like HRI would probably be more the main conference from like social science or people that study robotics. ICRA, or International Conference on Robotics and Automation, is the top conference for people who study more engineering related. ICWSM, triple worldwide web conference, and web search and data mining. So once again, even in a conference, I publish across a different types of conferences, different venues and conferences. And the conferences that I mentioned here are conferences that are considered to be equivalent to journal outlets. I also publish in other conferences other than these. I also got funding from a lot of different areas. And so some from private, some from the government, and that ranges from NSF to the Army. Also have done a lot of work with transportation, with MCity and the Toyota Research Institute. And as Brian mentioned, I've been on interview, TV, video, wrote op-eds for various media outlets. Actually, one of my students from South Korea, and he went home to visit his family and sent me back an email and said that he saw me on the nightly news in South Korea. Apparently, it's like, I was on nightly news. So I thought that was actually, sent me a clip of it. It's kind of interesting. So when you do these interviews, it's hard to know where they end up at, right? They cycle through the press. So some of the things I've recently done, Reviewer Hall of Fame for JAIS. I was really proud of this recently. My lab, I'm a founder and director of the Michigan Autonomous Vehicle Research in a Group Collaboration. And we actually was part of the Ted Kennedy Family Faculty Team Excellence Award. It's basically an engineering award given by the College of Engineering for research group. So I was pretty proud of that. Also, I was pretty proud recently, one of the first papers I did in human interaction with autonomous vehicles was actually awarded the Vince Benick Automotive Electronic Engineering Best Paper Award. And this was from SAE International. And it was, so I was, this award was like first given in 1976, I think it was. And so SAE is a pretty well-known, professional society for engineers. And so I was pretty excited about the fact that they were acknowledging this type of work, in their award. I think in the past 20 years, most of the awards have been much more technically oriented than human interaction oriented. Also, best paper awards from JAIS. 2 years ago, actually it was last year, but it was like 2 years ago for the award. The same award was there with robots, emotional attachment, preference, and viability, and team collaborating with robots also was nominated as one of the top papers in AIS that year. And then also I got an award from ACM on monitoring and trust in virtual teams. So I publish a lot across a lot of different areas. I do relatively a lot of different things in some ways. In some ways, I would say not, but I've, it's like one of those things. If you're in an iSchool and I'm in an iSchool, you can walk a lot of different areas. And so one of the things that help, because, if you go to iSchool, iSchools are places that, and they're not so much yet communities. So if you go to iSchool, are you an ACI person? If you're an ACI person, are you a Sig Chi ACI person? Are you AIS? ACI person, are you both? But it helps, whatever you do, one rule of thumb is try to do it well. So whatever you do, whoever sees it is going to say, oh, this is good stuff. And so that's a good indication. Also, remember AIS distinguished member, I guess I should apply for the cum laude one. I guess I'm waiting on that. I should just do that this year too. So here we're talking about trust and working with robots. So I'll give you a heads up on this. So I'm going to present, in this paper I've actually done, I've done two studies. I'm going to present the second study, and I'm in the process of doing a third study. So like any feedback you can give, be great. I can use that because we're in the process of planning the third study for this paper to make up for any issues that we have with this study. So any feedback you give me would be great. So let's talk about the motivation behind this. And once again, I'll go back to trusting and working with diverse robot coworkers. So the challenge, so now organizations, and I've talked to some organizations, they're really, ideally you hear talk about robots coming into the workforce. And the first thing you hear is that, okay, they're going to be taking human jobs and humans are going to be replaced. Some of that is true. Some of that is true. But the fact of the matter is, it turns out that humans are pretty useful things, right? Humans are really good at solving problems. They're pretty flexible. They're really good at ad hoc. Automation, like robots, are really good at doing the same thing over again without hurting themselves and doing it correctly. They also can be very good at lifting heavy weights. So the workforce of the future isn't going to be robots or humans. It's going to be a combination of both, right? And so now you're seeing a lot of companies like Amazon are asking their employees to work side by side with robots, right? And and so on one hand, you know, robots are definitely seen as different as a human coworker. And then as they're trying to build this cohesive workforce, they also realize that people are afraid of robots. They think they're going to take their jobs. There's this fear that, hey, you know, this robot that I'm working with, you know, eventually I won't have a job. That's also the realization that that people, on one hand, we may take a job to make money, but we stay at a job to see our friends. We know from organizational research that social relationships are a big reason why people stay at a job. And so, you know, if people are going to work to see their friends and then you replace their friends with a robot, I mean, that's not an easy thing, right? People get a lot of social interactions from work that they could lose, right? So these organizations are trying to find a way to integrate human and robotic workforce in a way that sort of works pretty well and understand when it does work well and when it may not work well. So that's my practical motivation. So from my academic motivation is a little bit different. So as I've been studying human interaction with robots, you run across two types of theories. One theory to explain human interaction with robots is like the ACI theory, human interaction with a machine. And a good example of that, maybe TAM is a good example of that kind of thing, right? TAM that assumes that human interaction with a machine. And then you have these other papers where they take human to human theories, right? And they apply them, right? So you can imagine that in the literature, you have the robot is viewed as either a teammate or a tool. And so when it's a teammate, they apply human to human theories. When it's a tool, think of a human to technology interaction theories, right? And the question becomes like, okay, when should you use what? Right? Or doesn't even matter. It doesn't really matter, right? Or when does it matter? All right. So these are some of the questions that have come up to me as a scholar from a big picture, like thinking about long term, right? As we begin to look at these interactions. So when it comes to diversity, and I chose diversity as a lens because so I'm going to define diversity as differences are perceptions of differences. So people will say that it's ultimately not the differences that matter, is the perceptions of differences when it comes to the impact of social relationships, right? Now, we do know from past research that diversity matters in human-to-human interactions. Right? Humans often do not trust and do not prefer to work with people who are different than them. Not always, but in general, that shows up. We also know from research that humans are very much likely to view robots as being different than them, than being similar. That's nothing we find out. So open question is, you can imagine that we use diversity theory to understand if people are going to work and trust with other people. Can I use this theory to understand when humans are going to work with a robot? All right. So is this diversity lens may or may not be appropriate for HRI, right? Because I remember I talked about this idea of these human-human theories. Maybe they're good. Maybe they're not. Maybe they're problematic. So from a research question, I'm going to look at can differences between humans and robots help us understand when humans trust and prefer to work with robots over humans? Because I want to look at the idea of a preference. And does those differences between humans and robots have the same impact as those differences between humans, right? So one, is it useful to use this theory, right, to understand if humans can work with robots? And then two, does it work the same way as it does with humans and humans, right? So implications, well, we know implications for HRI scholars. Hey, we can use this theory of diversity to understand how people are going to react to robots. And implications for the bigger picture, well, you know, Maybe is it appropriate? There's some example of saying, yeah, it is appropriate to use the human-human theories, or maybe not. Maybe they behave a little differently. So let's write that. So the theories of diversity and trust in humans. And so Brian, I know there's some questions. So typically I forgot to mention, if there's a clarifying question, I'll be happy to answer at any time. Other than that, I'll wait. So theories of diversity and trust. So basically the underlying mechanism behind diversity and trust in organizational literature is that we as humans, we engage in what we call self and social categorization, and really unconsciously. So imagine that we meet someone initially, and then we meet that person, we categorize ourselves relative to them, and then we engage in this in-group versus out-group, right? And so people that we think in this comparison are like us, we put in the out-group. People that we think are not like us, people we think are like us are in the group, people we don't are in the out-group. It's important to know that what we use can be arbitrary. There's not one thing. Part of the reason why race and gender are so powerful is that they're oftentimes the first thing that we see in a person. So if it's the first thing that we see, it triggers this process, but it could be arbitrary. There's not one thing that we use, right? It's relative to the people around us. So, and so what happens, so the in-groups become our social group, right? So I see you, I see me, you know, I see you, I compare you to me. If I think you're like me, however that may be, I put you in my in-group, right? You're like me. If not, I put you in the out-group. You're not like me. So then there's something called the similarity attraction phenomenon. It is the tendency of people to be attracted to people who are similar to them, right? So what happens? So if people who are like me, I put in my in-group, I think are like me, I should say, we tend to view them as similar to us across many dimensions, unrealistically. We just assume they are like us on a lot of different areas. And we tend to like them, and we tend to care for them more. And we also assume that they are really good people, and they're hardworking, and they're honest. And why is that? Because it's self-serving, right? If you're like me, you got to be honest, you got to be hardworking, because I'm an honest, hardworking, right? So this is how we get this in-group bias going on here. Out-group, so it sort of varies on how this goes. So on one hand, you can have a case where you know, if someone's out-group, they tend to be them. So you know, the out-group is them. And then we minimize their differences. So all of them are the same, right? Worst case scenario, all of them are bad people. And so unknowingly, we can engage in bias against them. That's unknowingly unconscious bias. But you know, we can even maybe in extreme cases, normally discriminate against them. So that's like the underlying mechanisms of diversity. So there are different types of diversity. I'm gonna use the categorization that Harrison had. And so basically we can categorize diversity as things we call as surface level diversity. These are things that we see, gender, age, race. And then there's deep level diversity of values, attitude, and beliefs. So, and the idea is that the two don't have to be related, right? We could be of different gender, but have the same values and beliefs, right? And so surface level is what I see that are different, but it doesn't mean we have deep level diversity. In theory, they can be orthogonal, right? From a purely academic standpoint. In reality, they're often not, all right? In reality, they're often not. Oftentimes, because of your gender, race, and age, you're often segregated in certain neighborhoods, certain areas. You also get treated a certain way based upon your gender, age, and so forth. And so we end up with a lot of similarities and values and beliefs and attitudes. And so here, what I have here is like basically the election, not the last election, the election before that election. I should update this one. If you look at the voting by race, you see that you can look and see quite clearly that, you know, that the majority of white people voted for Trump when it comes to Clinton, and the majority of people who would probably be classified as either non-white or Hispanic, Asian or Black voted for Hillary Clinton. Right. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that, you know, surface level and deep level diversity are many times often related. So generally, the general theories of diversity and trust in human coworkers kind of work like this. You have diversity, not all the time. People will say that, you know, depends on the number of interactions, but generally the theories of diversity say that these things generally reduce your trust in a coworker. And your trust in a coworker is very important to your willingness to want to work with that coworker, right? And so the idea behind this is that the more different someone is of you, the less likely you are to trust them and cooperate with them, and the less likely that you're going to want to go and work with them. Now let's talk about trust in robots. Let's go back. So from this standpoint, I'm going to go to the HRI literature. So but beforehand, I was talking a lot about the organizational literature. So I'm going to go to the HRI literature. So in the HRI literature, we know that humans can and do trust robots. We also know that trust in robots is actually important. When people trust the robot, they enjoy interacting with the robot. They cooperate with the robot more. So trust is actually important. And a lot of these papers use human-to-human theories, right? So a lot of these papers are using what we call interpersonal trust between humans and robots to understand and predict, you know, if someone's going to enjoy the interaction or going to cooperate. So now let's go to take a step back and talk about anthropomorphism versus dehumanization. And I want to talk about what these are and why they're potentially important. So anthropomorphizing robots. Anthropomorphism is this idea of immuning some object, imagine or real, with non-human agent, with human-like characteristics, motivations, and intentions, and emotions, right? So to anthropomorphize an object is to make it more human-like than it actually is. When it comes to robots, for example, we know people go and project human-like attributes to robots, like gender, personality, preferences, and emotions, right? I was actually talking to an executive of a robot company, a personal assistant robot, and he repeatedly referred to the robot as she, right? The result is that we unknowingly treat robots like humans. So this is the anthropomorphizing via robots, which underlies this idea that we can use human-to-human theories. Now, why does this happen? So this is pretty common, that the humans tend to anthropomorphize anything that moves, pretty much. Now, why is that? So one theory behind this is that many, you know, thousands of years ago, when our ancestors was like on the, in the jungle, right? So one of our ancestors was in the jungle. He or she was in the jungle, and they were hunting, and then all of a sudden they saw some bushes, some weeds move around over there, started moving. And one of our ancestors saw that and said, you know what? That is something coming to eat me. Though, you know, that movement in the bushes, it has intention, it has agency, it's going to kill me. I'm getting the heck out of here. And that person took off running. Our other ancestor saw the weeds moving and said, you know what? That's probably nothing. It's probably just the wind. And that person got eaten. You go forward, the person who assumed that was something to eat them lived, had kids, and here we are, hardwired to anthropomorphize things that move. So that's one of the evolutionary explanations of it, right? But the idea is that humans anthropomorphize robots, and if they do, then okay, we can use human-to-human theories, right? Because it says that basically you and I are going to assume the robot is like a human and treat it like a human. Now, the other view is that people engage in this dehumanization of robots, right? Which is basically we deprive someone of something of human characteristics. So the idea is that we take away attributes of humans. And there's like research, there are people who are beating up robots or beating up autonomous vehicles, right? And the idea is that people don't see robots like humans. And quite the opposite. They devalue them or dehumanize them. They see them, you know, when they see robots, they deprive them of some human characteristics, right? And so in that sense, you can say, well, people knowingly or unknowingly treat robots like machines. And if that's true, then you can say, well, this theory of human, of using human theories are not appropriate, right? So that's the other view of it. So think about it. If we engage in dehumanization, if we see a robot, if we see this machine in the printer, then we shouldn't use human-to-human theories. If we engage in anthropomorphizing, then we can say, okay, well, maybe we should use human-to-human theories to understand human-robot interactions, for example. So if we look at, if we go back to this, you know, to the overall literature, we can say this, that basically, if we're going to use a human-to-human theory to understand this model for robots, then we're basically saying that people are engaged in this anthropomorphism, right? And then it should behave the same way it behaves with a human. If not, then perhaps something's going on. Perhaps, you know, there's some dehumanization going on, but perhaps we shouldn't be using, or we shouldn't expect these theories to behave the same way, right? And then that would say we might want to reconsider our use of human-to-human theories. So here's the research model here. So we have here surface level, deep level, impact your trust in a coworker and your preference work for about a coworker. We're going to look at the impact of surface level and deep level on trust very by the different type of coworker. So we're going to actually want to work with a robot versus a human. So let me break it down a little bit more detail. So hypothesis one. So the idea is that the impact of surface level is going to vary by the type of coworker, human or robot, its impact on trust. So the idea is that surface level, we know from diversity theory, reduces trust in human. In part, to some extent, it does lead to some level of dehumanization of even individuals, right? When I put you in in-group, out-group, if I put you in the out-group and I say, you're like them, all them are the same, right? There's some, that in itself is some level of dehumanization. It can go farther or not, right? But there's some level of dehumanization. For a human coworker, it's hard to take this to a full level of dehumanization because as much as you think they are them or someone else, you are reminded that that is indeed a human being. It is a human, right? So there's a sort of, imagine that there's a, this cognitive pushback to say, no, this is really a human being. Even if you devalue that person still is a human being. But in a robot coworker, that won't happen. So you imagine that if being different leads to dehumanization, in the case of a robot, there's nothing to really remind us that, no, this is really a human. Quite the opposite. We know, in fact, that it is not a human. So what does that mean? That means basically we're expecting the impact of surface level diversity to be much more negative when it comes to a robotic coworker, right? So coworker type will moderate the negative effect of surface level diversity on trust in a coworker, such that the negative effect of surface level diversity on trust in a coworker is stronger for a robotic coworker than for a human coworker. Now let's look at deep level diversity and coworker trust. So deep level diversity reduces trust in a coworker and similar because we often see the other person as being different. There's some level of dehumanization. Now, here's the thing that makes it a little bit unique. For a robot coworker, when it comes to cognition, values and beliefs associated with that, there's something called mind attribution. So when we dehumanize a person or anything else, we basically, we take away the mind attribution. So for example, if someone's a member of the out group, I don't see them as individual with their own thoughts and beliefs. I see them as a member of a group and they're all the same. They all think the same. So I don't like say, oh, this person is individual with their own beliefs. I got to value, like, no, they're just like them and they all think that way, right? So we take away this mind attribution, right? So that's part of the issue behind this dehumanization. So, but in the case of a robot, what happens when you dehumanize is that you have a heavy amount of what we call lack of mind attribution already, right? When robots think think differently, or when robots think, we don't attribute the thinking to the robot itself. We tend to attribute the thinking to the person that programmed the robot. And so the dehumanization process for the robot is that we don't credit the robot with their own values and beliefs. So with humans, it's sort of different, right? When humans are different, we actually do hold them. It's like, okay, that's that person's responsibility, right? That's what they're thinking, right? So the result of that is that, the coworker type will moderate the negative effect of deep level diversity on trust in a coworker, such that the negative effect of deep level diversity and trust in a coworker is actually weaker for a robot coworker than for a human. So when the robot thinks differently, because we're likely to not attribute as much mind attribution to the robot, when we dehumanize the robot, we don't hold them as much accountable compared to a human. So go a little bit further here. So let's look at coworker trust and preference in a coworker. So we know that coworker trust increases preference to work for a coworker. So the more you trust your coworker, the more you want to work with them. So if you trust the robotic coworker, you're going to want to prefer to work with the robot over a human. Now, the thing that would be different is that the more you trust your human coworker, the least likely you want to prefer to work with a robotic coworker, right? And so we put that sort of in the view here. that coworker type will moderate the impact of coworker trust and preference to work with a robot over a human, such that trust in a robotic coworker will increase the willingness to work with a robot over a human. But in addition to that, trust in a human coworker should decrease the willingness to work with a robot over a human. So the more you trust your human coworker, the less you want to switch and work with a robot. So let's go. So once again, here's the research model. Now we'll talk about the actual method. So the actual method was an online method, and I'll walk you through it. We actually did this online study. It was a randomized study. So participants, we actually used 347 actual warehouse workers. Mean age is about 40. We got a split between males and females, paid them $20 for participation, because the actual, I'll show you the actual study, was in the context of working at a warehouse. And warehouses are expected to, warehouses are one of the areas where robots are expected to have a huge impact in the next 5 years, if not already. So we, in this study, we conducted a between subject study of a 2x2x2x2. So let me explain. We manipulated surface level, either high or low, deep level, high or low. And then we also manipulated situational risk. So there's some literature that says that people might prefer to work with a robot coworker if it's a dangerous situation, right? And then we manipulated coworker type, whether you were asked to work with a robot or a human. And we, you know, we had control variables in there. So now I'll walk you to the actual experimental how it was set up. So they logged onto a site. They filled out a consent form. They put in their demographic information and control variable. At this time, they were randomly assigned to a treatment group. And so imagine at this stage, you can be randomly assigned to four treatment groups. So you can either go to the robot or the human. And if you went to the robot, you can either be assigned to a robot named Jessica or a robot named David. The robot named Jessica had a female voice and the robot named David had a male voice. Or if you were assigned to a human coworker, the human coworker was either Jessica or David and had a female or male voice, right? So you can be randomly assigned to one of these four conditions. And then there was a video. The video ran and the robot introduced him or herself. And, you know, if you were in a robot condition, you know, and if it was David or whatever, or Jessica, it was same voice, same name. They show you all that they can do in the warehouse, like all the things that they were capable of doing. They introduced themselves. If you were assigned to the human, it was a video, the same voice, same name, David or Jessica, going through the same task. Now, in the human video, we wanted to minimize the potential confounds associated with things like attractiveness and race. So in the human video, you never actually see the human's face, or you never see actually their race, right? So we sort of, because we wanted to control for things like that. So we avoid having the video show the human worker's face or skin color or anything like that. But they were doing the same task. The two videos had the same text and the same time. And then we they also fill out a survey about their individual work ethic as a participant, about, you know, their work habits and ethics and values and beliefs about work as an individual. And then they, at this point, they were assigned, then the robot or the person is either someone, if they had a robot, could be Jessica or David, but also that robot could have similar values and beliefs as them or different. If they're assigned to a human, it could be Jessica or David. And within that, Jessica or David could have the similar or different values as and beliefs as the participant. All right. So this is how we manipulated deep level diversity. And then you were assigned to either to work in a warehouse where you had to store something that was a biohazard material, which we consider to be high risk situation, or something that required you to store just regular wooden boxes, something we consider to be low risk task, right? But both, you know, the whole experiment was working with a coworker in a warehouse. Once again, these were warehouse workers, so we sort of kept it as real as possible to some extent, right? And then you complete a survey about your trust in a human or robot. and then your preference for working with a robot over the human, and you would debrief, paid, and release. So we use generalized least squares to test the hypothesis. We had the control variables, and here's what we found. So results one, well, first of all our manipulation checks work. So we checked that surface level, deep level, risk, everything worked out. And our measurement model all worked out. What does that mean? Everything, all the instruments had reliability over 0.7, alphas over 0.7. All of the loadings loaded 0.7 or higher on their respective constructs, and all of the cross loadings were less than 0.3. So once again, that worked out well. So the empirical model manipulation checks all work out. So hypothesis one, so let's look at it. It was supported. This is what we found. So basically what we find is that when it was a robotic, well, when it was a human coworker, this line was actually not significant. It was just a flat line. All right, so we didn't see much effect there, but for the robot coworker, we saw a significant negative effect. So basically, and this idea that surface level actually had a more negative impact when it comes to on trust when it came to the robot coworker, right? And so we see here the y-axis is trust in the coworker, x-axis is surface level diversity, low and high, and the dotted line is for the robot, the straight lines for the human. All right, so once again, the idea was that the effect would be more negative for the robot than the human, and we find support for that. So hypothesis two, when it comes to deep level diversity, we also find support. And so here we go. Once again, on the y-axis, we have a trust in a coworker. X-axis is the deep level diversity, low and high. Solid line, human coworker. Dotted line, the robot coworker. And we see here for the robot coworker, deep level diversity doesn't have much of an impact at all, right? But for the human coworker, we see a strong negative impact. So that would support it. Then we look at the impact of trust in a coworker. Hypothesis three was supported, and here's what we found. So the y-axis is preference for robot over human. The x-axis is the degree of trust that you have in your coworker. And so if you were asked, you know, imagine that if you were asked to trust the robotic coworker, to what degree you trust the robotic coworker, you had a preference to work with a robot over a human. Here we find the opposite. To what degree you trust your human coworker, you were less likely to want to work with a human robot coworker. Right. So basically, we find is that people who trusted the human coworker was less likely to want to work with a robot coworker. So what does this mean? So some of the findings. It turns out diversity seems to be a useful lens to understand when humans trust and prefer to work with robots. However, the impacts of differences are actually different than human and robots, right? So the theory is useful, but it doesn't seem to behave the same way for when it comes to understanding if or how people want to work with a robot versus another human. And we did find that trust toward a human coworker actually reduces your preference to want to work with a robotic coworker, which actually has some interesting implications, right? And I've been hesitant to say this. I may come back to it later. So let me see if I come back to it later after these limitations. So some of the limitations, artificial nature of the experimental research, short duration, examine specific types of diversity and deep level. So theoretically, we're talking about surface level and deep level diversity, but practically we looked at one type of each. And so that doesn't mean that it would hold for all types, right? So our contributions, extend the research on human-robot interaction by demonstrating the importance of diversity, extend the research on diversity by highlighting the impact of dehumanization. So it turns out that we had this dehumanization going on that actually, that diversity actually behaves a little differently. Extend the research on trust to the robot by showing how it reduces the preference to work with a coworker. So here's a caveat that I'm hesitant to say. Ideally, if you went to Amazon, for example, and you know Amazon's is trying to get people to work with robots, ideally you would say, well, you know, if you could find somebody who believes that their coworkers are different from them and they don't trust them, that person would probably be much more willing to work with a robot than somebody who works with their coworker think they're like them and do trust them, right? Not sure that's something that I want to say from a practical standpoint, but actually, you know, you can look at it from that standpoint. Going forward, so it sheds some light on the idea of using human-to-human theories for HRI. It's like, maybe it's not always a good thing, right? I mean, perhaps they behave differently. We shouldn't assume, we shouldn't appropriate these human-to-human theories to understand human-to-robot theory, because not only could they be wrong, they could be really wrong. It could be wrong to the point of misleading. Also some implications about working with robots in the organization. And that's pretty much it. At this point, I want to thank my student, Sang Suk Yu. He's co-authored on this paper. He's actually the lead author on the paper that I'm presenting. And here's some of our other work if you're interested in.
Thank you very much for the interesting and kind of thought-provoking talk. Just so that everyone knows, again, we'll do question and answer with the chat. If you ask a short, easy question that I can repeat, I may just repeat it out of the chat. If it's a long, complicated question, I'll probably give you the ability to talk. So I guess that creates incentive. But if you have questions, you know, feel free to put things in the chat. And one question I had just to kind of get things started. So in your experiment, it's a single person and a robot kind of interacting. Do you think the results you have or the way to think about it is different if you had a person, you know, essentially you had groups that had robot members and human members? So if you had a group that had three humans and one robot versus three robots and one human in terms of their interaction, or you know, is there something about the larger context?
Yeah, I think so. I think there is something about the numbers that might change, right? So it has to, I would imagine it'd be different. Imagine if you're a human working with two robots or a human working on a robot and another human. That would probably change the dynamics, right?
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we have a question in the chat from, actually, I'll just give the person the ability to talk. 1 second.
Yeah. You're right.
So this is William Bezinski. You have the ability to ask your question. Go ahead. You can unmute and ask the question.
I'll paraphrase the thing I just put into chat. Boston Dynamics and Ghost Robotics make robot dogs, and they're continuously improving them. Recently, the New York Police Department, I believe, stopped using the Boston Dynamics dogs. Do you have any comments about why the NYPD has done this? I would expect that the behavioral expectation on the part of the person working with the robot dog would be lower than any expectation they would have of a human colleague, because they're expecting dog-like behavior rather and dog-like similarities rather than human-like similarities. That's all I've got to ask. Thank you for any comments.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So yes, let me. I'm actually pretty familiar with this. So here's how it works. So on one hand, theoretically, I'm not sure if everybody else knows, but like the NYPD. So they decided to roll out a robot dog, but they did it unannounced. They didn't tell anyone that like somebody was doing something, and they walked outside with this robot dog they were using. So technically, it should be better, because the robot dog cannot bite you, right? It doesn't bite. What the robot dog really does is observe. Like it doesn't really have the ability it can follow you, it can observe you, but it really doesn't it can't really attack you, right? So the cop saying, can't say, go sick him, because it doesn't bite. But if you ever saw the video that caused the stir, it was a huge shock, right? You see the police officer comes out with this robotic dog. It looked like an apocalyptic sci-fi horror movie. I mean, it just did. I mean, show the video, right? And I actually did it. So I actually did an interview on this topic in New York. And it's like, well, I did an interview. I'm not sure if it ever got published or what. But my suggestion was that before they roll this thing out, right? So on one hand, we know from a purely technical standpoint, theoretically, it should be safer, right? Because one, it doesn't bite you. Two, it has a camera. So like, if you worry about, if you're pro recordings when it comes to police officer, this particular dog would have been like for you, right? I mean, it was because it has the ability to record a 360 degrees, right? The way it's set up. And so like, you think, okay, this is like a way to keep an eye on the police officer, all right? But I told them, I said, no, they should have talked to the community. They should have introduced that dog, the robot dog, into, they should have went to meetings with the community, talked to the community, explained the technology to the, you know, to the community, explain what the dog can and cannot do. And I also argued they should have got acceptance from the community when it came to that robot, right? To see what the people think about having that robot. And they didn't. They just literally like rolled it out. And I'm not even sure, like, you know, no one knew they had it until the video. It was like an ad hoc video. Like someone was there recording something else when the doll came out. And it was just, and it was just like, and considering all the tension going on with policing right now, they could have rolled it out as a solution, right? But they didn't. And so it's like one of those things where basically, if you leave a lot to be imagined, people are going to imagine. And in absence of information, people assume the worst. That's just the way, you know, they assume the worst. And so, yeah. And so people, so they have to stop it. If they would have introduced that to the community, explained the technology and presented it as a solution to some of the problems, right? I think they would have gotten a lot more support, but they didn't do that. But yeah, so that's one of the things where basically, I mean, all technology, you know, if it's going to involve people, I mean, think about it, right? You're asking these people to accept that robotic dog in their community, right? I mean, that's, and somehow they should have some permission, some education, some awareness of what's going on. And they didn't. And so, yeah. And as wonderful as that Boston Dynamic dog is from a technical perspective, the damn thing looks pretty scary. I mean, it looks pretty spooky, right?
Well, this is the questionnaire again. I mean, my understanding is that at least with the BD dogs, is they are definitely not weaponized, and nor yeah. will they ever be, as long as BD makes them to weaponize exactly. them. So they should not be a threat. I agree with you that they should have been introduced to the community before they were put into use to get some acceptance or at least some understanding on the part of the community.
Exactly. Exactly. So you just said, oh, they're not weaponized and they never will be, right? Those are the kind of things that the community should have heard, right? Because I think you're absolutely right. I mean, in some ways, that was a solution to a lot of problems. It could have been viewed as a solution. It could have been like, if you're a person and you see a dog coming and you need help, you might want to run to that dog, not run away from the dog, right? But it's just, yeah. So, I mean, it could have been a solution, but they failed to do a lot of the upfront work. Mm-hmm.
So again, if anyone else has questions, you can feel free to put them in chat. Otherwise, I have questions I can ask Lionel. Lionel, I know you've got your research lab, your research group that works with autonomous vehicles, and I know you've done a lot of really interesting work with that. How do you see the, you know, you're doing things here with robots and comparing them with people? Is that the same approach you're doing with autonomous vehicles, or is there other things that you're looking at with autonomous vehicles?
No, it's a combination. So what we do with autonomous vehicles, we look at things like trust. So for example, and we do, I do use the lens of teaming, right? And we try to use some of the theories of why do people trust things like transparency. But it's a good question about how much of the human-to-human theories we can use. We actually have that discussion now. So typically what we've been doing is we do human user studies, get data based upon how the human reacts to a particular design feature, use that data, create a model, run simulations in that model, and develop a controller for the autonomous vehicle. So it's this cyclical approach, right? But there is this idea of inherently that there's some level of humanization, right? Because the AV has autonomy. And so the question we're working on now is how much is it like, right? So we have a paper now we're working on. So matter of fact, paper now we're working on, where basically most of the papers on human autonomous, really human, so human trust in robots, and human trust and robot trust in the human. So in this paper, we're looking at two things. We call it a bidirectional trust model, where we have a model that predicts if the human trusts the robot. There's actually, that's a whole lot of that going on. But we also have a model of what the robot can use to determine if it should trust the human, right? If you let the human drive or blah, 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 right? And so one of the things that we did in this model that other people didn't do was we actually, we imported what we call non-performance factors. So typically what they do is they say, okay, Ken, so you know, if you're the robot, well, if you're the human, your prediction of trust on a robot is, can the robot perform the job, right? And so you can say, well, the robot should also look at the human the same way, right? Can the problem with that, at the very least, from the robot to the human, is the human is a human. So the robot uses non-performance metrics to assess the human's benevolence and integrity, right? And so the idea is that basically, at least on part of the robot cannot use just ability to determine if it should trust the human. It has to use non-performance metrics, right? And so that's a roundabout way of saying, yes, we do to some extent, and it's not clear how far we can take it.
Okay. And Ben Snyderman, Ben, has got a question. Okay. Is there a comment Ben. Or comment that's got kind of intersection of human-robot interaction, but also human interface design, human-robot interface design? Ben?
Thanks, Brian, for putting this together, and thanks, Lionel, for your very interesting talk. Very nicely done. I'm really pleased to hear you, and please, this is at University of Maryland, and I hope it'll be on YouTube so I can tweet it and spread the news about it. I, as always, we've been in touch before, and I like your theory-based and experimental approach to this, which is really making good contributions. The comment about the Boston Dynamics dog, it was announced publicly in television interviews and so on. And so it was presented. Maybe you can't go to every community building and have people gather to view the dog. You just won't get there. But the television interview certainly was intended to spread the news. But yes, that dog is a bit, is very scary. And the point is, it's unpredictable, which is what people worry about most. In robots, because they just don't know that it's not armed. They don't know what it can and cannot do. And you can't educate them into that. You need to design into it. Which brings me to my central question. Your 2x2x2 study is really interesting and ambitious. But you know, my concern is there, your treatments were robot versus human. And of course, there are many kinds of humans, but there are more importantly, many kinds of robots. And I do think the goal of a design is not simply the simple dichotomy of, are you using a robot or not? Okay, the goal is, what is the design of the robot? If the robot was designed with a good user interface, with a control panel, with a visual display that let users know what's happening, that it became predictable and reliable, yes, I think, and it did do the job effectively, I think people would come to use it. So I think you are already, but I would like to emphasize the role that you can play in advancing robot designs so that they become, rather than guided by some, you know, that they're mimicking humans, that they become something which shows the user, that respects the user, that gives the user the clarity that they're in charge of this robot and they know how to stop it and control it. And yeah. You know, the operator, yes, okay, let me stop there.
No. So here's the thing about it. I'm gonna say two things. One, you do what I like as an academic. You say, okay, you got these 2x2x2x2, right? But in essence, if I did what you did, I would have a 2x2x2x2x2x2x2x2, right? That's the problem, right? It's like, yeah, I could give it ears. I can do all these transparency things. But then you do sort of run out into like, what are you manipulating? And so
it's what you really want is a 3x2x2. Okay. You do want the three conditions, poorly designed robot, well-designed robot. And let's take, you know, just a simple case of a human, if that's a little bit simplified, but yeah, that would be.
Yeah.
I do think you want to show, because I don't even think you, I didn't see in your talk what the robot interface was like. I don't know how the user controlled it. And that's really the central issue that warehouse workers and others need to know that they're, you know, that they can stop the robot, that they're in control of it. They know what it's going to do in the next 10, 60 or 600 seconds.
Yeah, so good point. So in this study, I showed a video with the robot, you know, talks. You the robot talked to you, so that was the interface, right? But I like that. So I had this conversation with some people. I think it was a robotics company in Israel. We were talking about some, they have a startup. And this person asked me, I think it was, I was at ICIS, and he said, look, you know, because I was having this present, I was on a panel, I was talking about the problems of designing robots to be like humans, like how that be problematic, right? But the fact of the matter is, you know, you could take my results and flip it around and say, when the robot had a similar personality and a similar gender, the humans trusted it more. So on one hand, so the person asked me, he said, look, if I'm going to go out and make a robot that people are going to use, based upon what we know, it should be like a human and it should be like the person. And so why shouldn't I do that?
I think they trust even more a robot that they had full control of, just like, you know, digital navigation system or a digital camera. They have full control over it.
But if you assume that they will always have full control, I can tell you that like at Amazon, the humans that work with the robot don't have full control of the robot. Sure. That's not the case, right?
Yeah. Understand.
But you're right. Camera, you're right.
You don't get full control of aperture, jitter, motion, exactly, and all the other things. But you know, the things that do get done are predictable and reliable.
Exactly. So, and it kind of goes back to: do you see the technology as a machine, all right, or do you see it as something else, right? All right. This was like the whole idea, and the question. So this is not a question. I mean, there is what should happen, and then there's what happens, right? If people are hardwired, you know, to do it. So it's like if people are hardwired to do this, you could ignore it, but maybe at your own peril, right?
Well, and one question I would have about this, Lionel, to go back to your original question, is when does a human-human modeler approach work versus when does a human-machine approach work? I mean, some of the things Ben's describing, there are arguments that suggests that what makes a human and when we anthropomorphize is when it's not predictable, is if somebody is entirely predictable, that's called objectification. We don't like that. Mm. And so there's an interesting design question here of if you provide a screen on the front of the robot that says the next five things it's going to do, does that result in dehumanization where people start treating it like a machine? Or does that make it more comfortable as a human? Because now you have a predictability to it, and you know
I think like what Ben mentioned and you mentioned is like if you put a screen or you make it like remote control, then you are definitely bypassing the tendency to anthropomorphize it, right?
Yeah.
Those things are intentionally bypassing. Yeah.
I would put that more positively. Doing it that way makes for better designs that are more successful. That's what GPS. That's what Amazon. E-commerce, that's what digital cameras, that's what Bloomberg terminals do. There's lots of AI, but it's all user control.
Yeah. So here's the problem with it. So for example, I work with the military, I work with the Army, right? And one of the things we're doing in the Army with autonomous vehicles is the Army wants to reduce troop size. So right now, if you have a vehicle, there's a driver and assistant driver. And so the driver's driving, the assistant driver's keeping notes, doing other tasks, calling in reports, you name it, right? And they want to reduce troop size such that they have one person in that vehicle doing the task and the vehicle doing the driving. So the idea is that if a person has to control the robot, then you're not getting a much level, you're not leveraging that technology the way, right? You don't have two workers, you got one worker.
I believe you can improve the productivity of the worker, but that's a longer discussion, Lionel. Maybe we'll pick it up.
This is a great thing. We actually have following this, we have an opportunity in a different Zoom session for people to continue discussions or have other discussions.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lionel and Ben and Bill or William, I apologize, for the good discussion. Again, it's always a good time when you can start with a study that's comprehensible and get to basic fundamental questions about the nature of humans and technology.
Yeah. Yeah,
I think that's it. So thank you very much for the conversation and the comments.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.